In this season of light, we light this candle, the Christ candle, to remind us of God's light shining in the darkness. May we share this light of hope, peace, and justice in the world today.
To make sure you have your communion elements ready for when we are inviting you to be a part of our communion service later on this morning. Come and worship, all you who love and serve our God, who surrounds us with unfailing love and answers us when we call, who cares for the humble and lowly, and never abandons those in need. This is our God, worthy of our worship and praise. Welcome to worship.
Will you let the blind see if I could call? Set the prisoners free and never be the same. Will you kiss the leper clean and do such as this unseen and admit to what I mean in you and you in me? Will you love the you you hide if I would call your name? Will you quell the fear inside and never
It is so simple to say, yet so difficult to live out. Do not be afraid. Yet whatever fear burdens us, God will lift from our souls. Whatever foolishness we have uttered, God whispers mercy to us. Whatever wrong we have done, God's forgiveness is poured out upon us. I invite you to join with me as we pray to the one whose love is constant in every moment, in every place of our lives. God of wonder and joy, we look in the mirror and do not often see holiness reflected back. We long to be siblings with others, but too often the differences keep us apart. We yearn to be more compassionate, Yet it is often spite and malice we offer. We are so busy listening to voices of the powerful that we have trouble hearing the cries of loneliness coming from those around us. Forgive us. You call us to different lives so we might make a difference for all who hurt. You invite us into your kingdom so we might show the way others the way. You challenge us to take a risk by following Jesus Christ. so we might become your children once again. Open our ears, call us again, and use us. Amen. By God's grace, with God's grace, through God's grace, we are who we are meant to be, forgiven, restored, and called. Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Once, when he was standing on the shore of Lake Gennesaret, the crowd was pushing in on him to better hear the word of God. He noticed two boats tied up. The fishermen had just left them and were out scrubbing their nets. He climbed into the boat that was Simon's and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Sitting there using the boat for a pulpit, he taught the crowd. When he finished teaching, he said to Simon, "Push out into deep water and let your nets out for a catch." Simon said, "Master, we've been fishing hard all night and haven't even caught a minnow. But if you say so, I'll let out the nets." It was no sooner said than done. A huge haul of fish straining the nets past capacity. They waved to their partners in the other boat to come help them. They filled both boats, nearly swamping them with the catch. Simon Peter said when he saw it, fell to his knees before Jesus. "Master, leave. I'm a sinner and can't handle this holiness. Leave me to myself." When they pulled in that catch of fish, awe overwhelmed Simon and everyone with him. It was the same with James and John, Zebedee's sons, co-workers with Simon. Jesus said to Simon, "There is nothing to fear. From now on, you'll be fishing for men and women." They pulled their boats up on the beach, left them, nets and all, and followed him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Veronica. Let us pray. God, source of all light, by your word you give light to the soul. Pour out on us the spirit of wisdom and understanding, that our hearts and our minds may be opened to know your truth and your way. Amen. It's early in the morning, and Jesus is teaching on the shores of the Galilean Sea. There are so many people pressing in on him, just trying to hear what he has to say. Nearby are two empty boats. The fishermen who have been fishing all night are on the shore washing and mending their nets. They're empty, both the nets and the fishermen, for they have nothing to show for a full night's work. They are also exhausted. Whether or not they caught anything, they still fished all night, casting and recasting their nets. Once they returned to shore from a night of fishing, the fishermen had to clean their nets, washing off all the gunk and all the debris that the nets would catch. They also had to do the mending and the repairs, adding linen or flax, retying knots. All of this had to be done before they could go home and get some much-needed rest. It was hard, hard work. Jesus gets into one of the empty boats, Simon Peter's boat, as Peter is busy washing and mending his nets. I'm guessing Peter's not just physically exhausted and empty, he's probably also disappointed. And probably a little anxious, because he's not going to make any money that day, and he's not going to feed himself or his community, because there's no fish. Jesus, after he preaches and teaches, tells Peter to push the boat out into deeper water and let the nets out again. Even though we read in Luke's gospel that Peter complies, he protests first. "We just got in from there," he says. "We just did all that, all night long. And we didn't even catch as much as a minnow." We don't know how deep Peter sighs, or how far back into his head he rolls his eyes, or how low he slumps his shoulders, or how much sand he kicks underneath his feet. Because here, standing before him, is a carpenter, a teacher, telling the seasoned fisherman how to fish. But we know eventually Peter obeys. So out they go. And as soon as Peter's nets hit the water, his emptiness gives way to abundance. His weariness gives way to hope. His defeat gives way to faith. This story is rich with meaning, and we are reminded that it is our story too. It acknowledges our times of emptiness and despair, as well as offering encouragement for discipleship and recognition of our faith as a source of hope and abundance. This story tells the truth about our journey with God and the tension we often live. "I have been fishing hard all night, but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I'll let down the nets." This is a call story, the story of how Jesus calls Simon Peter and James and John to be his disciples. And according to the scripture, they leave everything, even the abundance of fish, and follow him. This is our call story too. Even in the midst of a pandemic, we are still called. We are still invited. We are still encouraged to go deeper, to drop our nets, to let go of our old routines, our old nets, our old identities, because we can't ever go back, to move forward in faith. I've been at Waukesha First United Methodist Church for 6 months now. And there have been challenges. Certainly because of the upheaval we find ourselves in, but also because of the decisions that need to be made, Because change in whatever form, a new pastor, a new COVID variant, a new year without a physical community around us, this change is hard. Also because collective grief weighs heavy on our hearts. Because we know the system of our society is broken, and sometimes that includes the institution of the church. There are some mornings when we, the church, and me, the pastor, end up on the shore with empty, tangled up nets, wondering what the heck went wrong. Wondering how we might respond to the call to follow Jesus. Wondering how long we can sustain living and serving in light of the tension. The hardest thing to do in these moments, and we all have them, is to say to God, "Yet if you say so, I will. I will cast my nets again. I will trust you. I will let go of everything I think I have control over. I will listen. I will respond in faith. I will follow." Every Tuesday when we meet as a staff, we read and discuss and process the scripture that we're going to share in worship on that next Sunday. So this past Tuesday in our staff meeting, we read the scripture that Veronica shared with us, and we talked about it. And Elizabeth on our staff said, "Boy, my favorite call story that concerns fishing comes from Sesame Street, when Bert and Ernie go fishing. They end up with a boat full of fish, but they use unconventional methods." So you can thank Elizabeth Ross for this recommendation. Bert is frustrated because they've been fishing for over an hour and they haven't caught a thing. Ernie says, "I'll catch some fish and I'll show you. I'll show you how I do it." Bert, discouraged, gloomy as he often is, hands Ernie the fishing pole and says, "Okay, show me." "Oh, I don't need a fishing pole," says Ernie. "I use a very special fish call, and they come when I call, right into the boat." Bert, skeptical and doubtful, says, "Okay, show me." So Ernie does. "Here, fishy, 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 fishy." You have to call really loudly," Ernie says, "so that they can hear you under the water. Here, fishy, 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 fishy." A fish jumps in the boat. Then another, and another, and another. And Bert says, "Let me try." So he does. Nothing. No fish. Ernie doesn't think Bert is loud enough. "Louder, Bert," he says. Bert gets louder, but not in calling the fish, just in complaining. "It doesn't work for me. I've been calling and calling, and they don't come." Ernie says, "Well, that's how loud you have to be. You have to yell just as loud as you are now." So Bert does. "Here, fishy, 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 fishy." And a shark jumps into the boat, looks at Bert and says, "You called?" I really don't know what the moral of this story is. I wonder if Bert maybe tried a different approach, he might get different results. I wonder if that's what our gospel lesson is about today. Jesus inviting us to try a different approach. You know, we won't be in a pandemic forever. Experts believe that eventually the coronavirus will become an endemic, looking more like seasonal flu. But we're not there yet. There is no official benchmark for when it will end and a new normal will begin. And even as challenging as it has been to serve, to lead, and to follow, God has been very good, providing abundant blessings. In the last few weeks, even in the midst of our difficult decision to suspend in-person worship, several folks, parishioners, friends you know, some you know very well, have come to me to tell me how God has placed a call on their hearts to serve in new and different ways, in different areas of ministry, music, leadership, teaching, witnessing. Our church friends are reaching out to us, letting us know how they are caring for their neighbors, how they are building community, how they are living out their star words. Our church leadership continues to be faithfully engaged in ministry, responding to the hard questions of how and when and what if. Even in these difficult days of not being together physically, more and more folks are connecting online. And they send their gratitude in messages of encouragement and in financial offerings for the church. Thanks be to God that we have a digital ministry team that is working incredibly hard so that we can be connected. There are so many faithful disciples casting out their nets in faith and hope, and we witness abundance. When Jesus took Peter out into deeper waters, he didn't say, "Let down your nets and see if there's anything there." He said, "Let down your nets for a catch." Did you hear the difference? He didn't say, "Let down your nets and see if there's anything there." He said, "Let down your nets for a catch." There, right there, marks the tension in which we live. Scarcity, abundance. When Jesus calls, Peter is hesitant and thinks that what Jesus is asking him to do is both unnecessary and too demanding. But he responds. And in saying yes to God, Peter discovers something new, something different. And when Peter responds to that invitation to a life of discipleship, a life of abundance, Jesus says, "Do not be afraid." May this be our good news. May it be so for all of us. Amen. As we prepare to celebrate Holy Communion, I invite those of you at home to look at the elements before you, to look at whatever it is that you are using to mark this day of the Lord's Supper. There's probably nothing all that special about those elements. Maybe you have a piece of toast or a bagel or a cracker, or maybe even an oatmeal raisin cookie. Maybe you had to dig in the fridge for juice. Maybe it's orange juice or grapefruit or apple juice. Or maybe you're hoping that no one notices that you are celebrating with coffee or water or maybe a Diet Coke. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because there is beauty in the ordinary. Because in the work of the Spirit, the ordinary becomes holy. As we break bread from miles apart, we bear witness to something we imagine from our sanctuary but cannot see, the expansive, far-reaching table of God. Siblings in Christ, your table might look like your dining room table or your kitchen counter or your coffee table or maybe even your own lap, but it is an extension of God's great banquet. And from the east and the west, the north and the south, you are invited to bear witness to an extraordinary meal in ordinary packaging. A feast of grace, a feast of love, a feast of hope at the table in the kingdom of God.
It is difficult to not be with the people we love, those we enjoy sitting with in worship, the folks we fellowship with after worship, those we might be worried about and missed desperately. I invite you to take a moment and say aloud the names of the people you wish were next to you at God's table today. Every time we as people gather around a table, Jesus is present in spirit. As so, too, our loved ones are with us. Let this be a comfort to us. We do call to mind those who need our prayers and God's comfort. There are many we cannot name, whose names we do not even know, but God knows. Let us be in a manner and attitude of prayer. Most merciful God, we come to you with open hearts and hands, lifting up those whose lives are most at stake, knowing that we are only as strong as the weakest among us. Today we pray for Iris Bolson moving to Fond du Lac on February 10th to be closer to her daughter. George Bentley, whose shoulder surgery was moved from last week to this week and will be on February 9th. Kate Carter, her siblings, stepmother Anne, and rest of family after the death of her father, Daryl Carter, on February 4th. Bill Zickow and family after the death of Betty's last sister, Robbie Nutt. And all those who are ill, including those facing COVID and those struggling with cancer. We also pray for the church and its many ministries, lifting not only our church before you, but also the Presbyterian chaplaincies at Avalon Square and Carroll University, as well as their pastors, Reverend Aaron Hiddle and Reverend Elizabeth McCord, and all the people that they serve. Provide all faith communities the courage and stamina to serve with strength and love. Provide all faith communities your love and grace. God of compassion, hear our prayers. Fill us with your grace and inspire us to be instruments of mercy and hope.
While we long to return to normal, to just be together, tasting the same bread, sharing the same cup, we cannot deny that there is still and always reason to bring our thanks and praise to you, loving God. Just look at us right here in this moment. Even apart, we are together, your people, a community of mutual support and love. Even separated from our church home, we are never separated from you. As you guided the Israelites through their wilderness and wandering, never forgetting or failing them, despite their fear and impatience at the long journey to normal, we trust that you are with us too, laying a new pathway to a new day. As our world yearns for stability and longs for the easing of ache, we wait in the quiet confidence as people of faith. It was your Son, Jesus, who modeled compassion for us. He paid attention to suffering. The anguish of health declined, and hearts broken, and hope waning, and he extended healing. He formed a company of disciples, a ragtag bunch like us, whom he gathered in to teach and to love, whom he sent out to teach and to love. So whether we are gathered or whether we are scattered, we are entrusted to the eternal promises of the one who lived and died and lives again to set us free from suffering and sin. And so we give thanks that in Christ new beginnings are possible. Remembering your constant faithfulness in the disorder of these days, we give thanks for the signs of your presence, even in these ordinary gifts of bread and juice.
On the night he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us be a community of health and hope givers, and as together we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again. God, pour out your Spirit upon us, wherever we may be. By your Spirit, unite us at your table, across the miles, with one another, with your children in every time and place, with the living Christ. May the taste of grace upon our tongues jog our memories of your faithfulness and energize us to live out your love for us through whatever tomorrow brings, until we break bread at your table in glory. Hear us as we pray in the quiet of our homes, of our hearts, wherever we may be, the prayer that Jesus taught us praying:
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This bread reminds us that any life, no matter how broken or sick or distorted it may become, can be made whole again. This cup reminds us that any life, no matter how empty or lonely or isolated it may become, can be filled again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I invite you to prayerfully partake in Holy Communion in whatever means you have. Holy God, even when all of this is over, may we never forget how you held us together while we were apart, how you built a table across the miles, how you call us to continue the work of table building. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you for accessing us online for worship today. We are glad you are here. And we hope that this worship service has inspired you to respond to God's work in your life. To get a better idea of all of the ministry available through First United Methodist Church, we invite you to go to our webpage and click on our announcements button. We also encourage you to consider inviting someone else to our worship community, and it's an easy opportunity to share our website, our links, our app with others so that they might also participate in our worship experience. We also want to share with you some highlights of things that are going on, especially in the coming week. So on Tuesday at 6:30 every week, we have a Zoom class, Living Faith Today. And on February 8th, the conversation is going to be about how the past 2 years of the pandemic have been a huge challenge for churches, but also an opportunity. And the group will focus on the state of our congregational infrastructure and ask questions about what we should be rebuilding and what we should be abandoning as we continue in this time together. If you are interested in the link for this class, either contact Joanne Wright directly or call our church office and we will get you that information. Then coming up on Saturday, February 12th from 9 to 11 a.m., our youth are going to be hosting a Super Bowl weekend mission drive-through collection for the food pantry of Waukesha County. That's Super Bowl as in S-O-U-P-E-R. This event will be held in our West parking lot and provide a contactless collection, so the youth will be able to take the things out of your car, your trunk, or your back seat without being in contact physically with you. The food pantry has specifically requested that we focus on canned fruit, cereal, and canned protein, such as meat or soup or pasta with meat. There is also an additional commonly needed items list that can be found on our website. We are grateful for your support of our youth as well as our community as we work to help to end food insecurity. Next Sunday, immediately following our worship service at 10:30, our men's breakfast that meets on the second Sunday of each month will be meeting this month on Zoom. If you want a link, you can contact Dirk Wilkin directly or again call our church office and we'll get you connected. This group gathers together to form community, to share with each other and discuss various topics, and it's a great way to get to know some people. We do believe that our ministry here at First United Methodist Church makes a difference in our community and in our individual lives. And so we are grateful for all who generously support us week after week with your financial gifts and offerings. If you haven't ever given before, we ask you to prayerfully consider what you might be able to offer. If you are a regular giver and you can give more, we ask you to prayerfully consider that as well. You can contribute by mailing a check to the church or giving online through our website or our app, or consider setting up an electronic funds transfer through our church office. We turn all that we offer over to God, trusting that God will bless it and use it for good.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light.
Many years ago, I had an opportunity to worship with leadership in our denomination, including several bishops. I was wondering about my call to ministry and wondering if saying yes to God was really what God wanted me to do. And in the middle of worship service, one of the bishops kicked off her shoe just as she was sitting comfortably while others were leading worship. And I noticed she had a huge run in her stocking. And I thought, wow, that's a bishop. There was another bishop seated next to her, and I just happened to glance, and I noticed the bottom of his robe was really dirty. I thought, wow, that's a bishop. And for some reason, God put those two examples in my life at that time to remind me of our frailty as humans. To remind me that we are called in the midst of stocking runs and dirty garments. We are called to say yes in that messiness. COVID is teaching us that we still must say yes, even in a day, in the time, in the days of turmoil. Things break. Things can be mended. Not with time, as they say, but with intention. Those who are offering worship leadership this morning, they all just said that word out loud. Intention. So we are invited to leave this time of worship, to move forward in faith, to go forward, to go out, to serve God intentionally, to share God's love joyfully, to share God's grace extravagantly, because these are all of the ways that God loves us. The broken world waits in darkness for the light of Christ, and this light is in each and every one of us. Let us shine our lights brightly. Go in peace, my friends. Let us serve God together. Amen.